Hello everyone. So, this lecture is on 5.1, evidence for evolution. And there's really three main pieces of evidence you're going to need to know: homologous structures, fossils, and selective breeding. So we're going to dive right in, but again, those are the three big words you're going to need to know: fossils, homologous structures, and selective breeding. Now, before we dive into that, remember that evolution occurs when a heritable characteristic changes over time. Now, really, evolution is when the heritable characteristic of a population changes over time, but with enough time, this can cause a species change or speciation. So the definition, the cumulative change in the heritable characteristics of a population. Here is a more fancier definition, which you'll understand once we have studied genetics. So when you're reviewing this later for the IB exam, this definition will make more sense to you. The changes in the allelic frequencies in the gene pool of a population over time. So I've put that in there if you're watching this video for review. That said, if this is the first time you're hearing this, then really this is the definition you need to know and that you can use on the IB exam. Now, Darwin, when he came up with the theory of evolution by natural selection, his theories had a few premises. The first one was that life does evolve. Life changes and always has changed based on which animals survive and which don't. This means that all life shared a common ancestor, and that as that ancestor moved into new habitats, those populations would have had different variations that are more successful and more likely to survive, causing changes in the generations over time. Because of that, that means that evolution happens very slowly. It never happens in an instant. It happens over many, many generations. And certainly speciation, enough evolution for a single population to turn into two different species, would be very slow and gradual. Now, he did say that over time, this could lead to new species. The diversity of life, the number of species that are alive today, is because of the gradual speciation of life. And finally, he said this happens because of natural selection, which is natural because there's variation and then nature selects which ones survive. That's natural selection. So, three main pieces of evidence for evolution are fossils, selective breeding, and homologous structures. Now, the fossil record provides evidence for evolution. You need to know that fossils show species that no longer exist, which means that that species on Earth have changed over time, and they show intermediate species. They show species between two that live today. So for example, humans did not evolve from chimpanzees. A chimpanzee will never turn into a human. That never happens. You don't get to go to the zoo and see a chimpanzee evolve. That said, humans and chimpanzees share a common ancestor. There was one population of an animal that was not a human and not a chimpanzee, and that population went into two different habitats. And in one habitat, the environment selected for genetic variations that led to change over time to make humans. And in another habitat, it selected for different genetic variations that over time made chimpanzees. And chimpanzees are stronger, they have better visual memories than humans, and longer arms, better for swinging through trees, etc., etc. Humans, generally speaking, are smarter. We're better able to work in large groups and problem solve. We stand upright, which helps us see over the plains and the tall grass where we evolved. And we have less hair, which helps cool us down. So again, we have a common ancestor. We didn't evolve from each other. That never happens. And in the fossil record, you can actually find that common ancestor. The fossil records allow us to find animals that are between animals that exist today, and also animals and plants that no longer exist, that are extinct. Both of these things show that there has been a change in the heritable characteristics of populations over time. so evolution happens. So the fossil record does show evidence for evolution. Now, what is a fossil? A fossil are ancient preserved remains of an organism, and they can be dated to the age of the rock they're in. Generally speaking, when something dies, it goes on the ground, and the next thing that dies goes on top of it, etc. The closer to the surface something is, the more recent it is. The deeper it is, the older that fossil is. That's called the law of vertical superposition, if you study geology. And on top of that, you can use things like radioactive dating to double-check it. And through both vertical superposition and radioactive dating, you can actually tell how old fossils are. That said, I want to point out that continuous fossil records are rare. To die in the right place at the right time, to not get eaten, but just actually fossilized, to be preserved, is quite lucky. So let alone having one, but having every different type of population that led to modern species is very rare. So most fossil records have large time gaps, depending on luck. But let's talk about an example, and note that you do not need to know the example for this assessment statement. But a great example of fossils with a fairly continuous set of populations is that of the modern horse, or equus. And we can actually see the horse change over time, from Hyracotherium to Mesohippus to Hipparion to Pliohippus to modern equus. So let's start with Hyracotherium. You do not need to know these names. Just think horses, good example of fossils showing evolution over time. Now, Hyracotherium was this little guy. I think they would have been adorable because they lived about 40 million years ago, and they were only 25 to 50 centimeters tall. They had small teeth, that's molars, without crowns. That meant that they did not eat grass. They did not have flat teeth for grinding grass. So they probably ate small, soft leaves. They also had toes, three toes on their front legs, four toes on their back legs, with little pads like dog's feet. And their eyes were halfway between the top of their head and the tip of their nose. So, baby cute horses that eat leaves. That's Hyracotherium, 40 million years ago. 30 million years ago, 10 million years later, we have Mesohippus, which was larger than Hyracotherium, with bigger, flatter teeth. So, could probably still used for eating leaves, but could start to eat grasses as well. And note that the number of toes in the front legs is the same, but in the back legs, they've lost a toe. Then, 10 million years later, we get to Merycippus, which was even larger than the one before, with even larger teeth that are now big enough that they probably mostly ate grasses. And they still have three toes, but the middle toe is getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and in fact was probably the only toe to touch the ground. The other two are kind of up and behind. And this is believed to be a direct ancestor of all modern horses. Then, 15 million years later, we have Pliohippus, which is even bigger in size, with even bigger teeth that they use to eat grasses, and now they only have one toe, like modern horses. And then finally, modern horses, which first appear in the fossil record about 2 million years ago, which were even larger than Pliohippus, with even bigger teeth, and just like Pliohippus, one toe. So in summary, these changes corresponded with environmental changes as we went from the Eocene to the Miocene to the present. The environment got drier and drier, so there were less leaves and more grasses. The harder ground and the harder, drier ground and more leaves meant that having less toes but a hard hoof and bigger teeth to eat the leaves would be useful. Also being bigger so that you can see above the grasses because you're not going to be able to hide in them, and run away faster would be selected for. Now note that more than one species lived at a time. So over time, again as a summary, the ancestor of the horse got bigger teeth, and lost toes. Now we can actually see it there, going from Hyracotherium, which had multiple toes, to one toe starting to get bigger, bigger, with these other toes slowly disappearing. In dogs, by the way, you can actually see one of the toes is kind of up and back behind, and they walk on, I think, three of their toes. And it's the same thing happening. Give it a few million years, they might actually lose those toes, because by natural selection, if you need to make less bones, right, calcium carbonate bones, if your body needs to make less bones, you can eat less to do that, which might help you survive, which would then be selected for giving you, making you able to have more offspring that are more likely to reproduce. That said, if those toes are useful, then having less of them by some mutation would actually be harmful and would not get passed on. And you can actually see things like Mesohippus and Myohippus lived at the same time as Merychippus, and Hipparion lived at the same time as Pliohippus, eventually going up to modern Equus, the horses of today. Do not memorize these names, but this is a really interesting and pretty complete example of fossils showing change over time, which is what evolution is. So here we go again. General idea of getting bigger with bigger teeth and going from more toes to just one big toe. Now, another piece of evidence for evolution is selective breeding. If evolution is the change in the heritable characteristics over time, then the fact that we took wolves and turned them into dogs is evolution. We changed the DNA of the wolf enough that when dogs have babies, they're not wolves. That's evolution, a change in the heritable characteristics over time. Now, this happened not because of natural selection. Nature had nothing to do with making dogs. Humans selected to make dogs. So instead of natural selection, this is selective breeding. And that's in fact how most domesticated animals evolved. Humans made them. The process is artificial selection because it's not nature, it's artificial selection. Humans were the selection, and this is through selective breeding. So, selective breeding. A breed is a type of domesticated animal, like a breed of dog, Chihuahua versus Great Dane versus German Shepherd. And breeds of animals were reared, they were made for human use. And they're clearly related to wild animals, right? Most domestic animals actually can still interbreed with wild ones. They're not different enough to really be different species, but they're going that way. So there's dogs and wolves, there's cats and wild cats, and there's goats and wild goats, mountain goats. And this shows that the domesticated breeds have been developed by selecting the traits we liked. Not the traits that were advantageous in nature, but the traits that we humans liked and breed from them. So these mean that over time it led to big differences in heritable characteristics, and it provides evidence that species can evolve quickly. So we can actually see the family trees going from wild cats to all the different types of cats based on what we bred for, all the way from the sphinxes, the sphinx cats that are hairless, to longer types of cats, longer haired cats like the Persians, etc. You can also see this in dogs, right? Going from things like coyotes and wolves through to all the different types of dogs. And this has been, we've looked at their DNA and we can actually see those family trees based on selection very, very well. Now, I want to show two quick videos, one that shows the evolution of dogs and another that shows a very funny example of natural selection. So first, the dogs.
Dogs. Dogs, 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 dogs. They're all dogs, they know they're dogs, and they recognize each other as dogs. Dogs are the most varied mammal species on the planet, but they can all procreate with each other. They often try. Despite obvious mechanical difficulties, it is technically possible for a Chihuahua and a Great Dane to mate. How did this happen? Where did dogs come from? How come there are so many different kinds of dogs? It's largely because of us humans. How did it all start? Dogs evolved from their wild ancestor, the gray wolf. In fact, modern dogs are still so closely related to the wolf that the two could interbreed and produce viable offspring. There are many theories that explain how we domesticated wolves. The most widely accepted is that this began when we formed relatively permanent camps. Wolves quickly learned that they could patrol the outskirts of our camps and feed off the scraps that we left behind. This relationship between wolves and humans proved mutually beneficial. The wolves got our food scraps, and we got protection. As the wolves guarded their territory and protected their pups from predators, they protected us as well. Some wolves are more aggressive than others. To protect ourselves, we eliminated them. Over time, it was the tamer wolves that bred, as the aggressive ones disappeared. As they further evolved, they learned to interact with us and interpret our gestures, becoming more and more domesticated. Eventually, they helped us to hunt and work. Varied environments, locations, and activities contributed to the evolution of different forms of these early dogs. As we began to cross paths with other groups of ancestors, we traded our dogs. Dogs were becoming physically different from wolves. Sizes changed, ears became floppy, and coats became more colorful. Wondering why, Russian scientist Dmitry Belyev studied tameness in canines. He observed that as they became tamer, their levels of adrenaline decreased. Adrenaline is linked to the hormone melanin, the pigment that controls fur color. He also noticed that with decreased levels of adrenaline, there was a lot more tail wagging. Extensive selective breeding has only been around since the 1800s, when affluent people started buying selectively bred dogs as status symbols. Breeders learned how to accelerate the natural pace of evolution by breeding early for certain desired characteristics. This process led to the wide array of breeds that we see today. In our zeal, though, the closed gene pools that result from selective breeding can create certain health problems for dogs. Some of these problems can include breathing problems, atopic dermatitis, itching, hip dysplasia, hearing loss, diabetes, blindness, cancer, cardiovascular diseases, some of which can cause death. Today, there are over 400 recognized breeds and an extensive list of recognized combined breeds: Labradoodles, Schnoodles, Puggles, Yorkie Poos, Maltie Poos, and Cockapoos. And of course, there are mutts. They're all our faithful companions. They're our best friends.
Okay, that showed a bit about how dogs evolved. Now I want to show a really fun one about artificial selection in crabs, narrated by the great Carl Sagan.
This legend raises a lovely problem. How does it come about that the face of a warrior is cut on the carapace of a Japanese crab? How could it be? The answer seems to be that humans made this face. But how? Like many other features, the patterns on the back or carapace of this crab are inherited. But among crabs, as among humans, there are many different hereditary lines. Now, suppose purely by chance, among the distant ancestors of this crab, there came to be one which looked just a little bit like a human face. Long before the battle, fishermen may have been reluctant to eat a crab with a human face. In throwing it back into the sea, they were setting into motion a process of selection. If you're a crab and your carapace is just ordinary, the humans are going to eat you. But if it looks a little bit like a face, they'll throw you back and you'll be able to have lots of nice little baby crabs that all look just like you. As many generations passed of crabs and fisher folk alike, the crabs with patterns that look most like a samurai face preferentially survived. Until eventually, there was produced not just a human face, not just a Japanese face, but the face of a samurai warrior. All this has nothing to do with what the crabs might want. Selection is imposed from the outside. The more you look like a samurai, the better your chances of survival. Eventually, there are a lot of crabs that look like samurai warriors.
Okay, so selective breeding of domesticated animals. Basically, if an animal has a characteristic that humans consider valuable or useful, then we select it for breeding. We choose that one to mate with other ones. And we hope that this characteristic will be passed on to the next generation so that this trait that we think is valuable will become more common. And in later generations, we might even get a more useful trait. So for example, milk. Milk cows. How do we get cows that make lots and lots of milk? Well, in the first generation, G1, some cows produce more milk than others. That's variation. And we take the cows that make the most milk, and we select those and breed those together. The calves, or the babies of these, are then produced. Now, that's G2, they're the second generation. In the second generation, some of these G2 cows also have variations, and some will make more milk than others. They still show variation. So, in the second generation of cows, we take those that make the most milk and produce those. And that makes a third generation that on average makes way more milk than the second or the first, because we keep choosing. And over time, this cycle is repeated and repeated and repeated until cows today make way more milk than wild cows. In fact, wild cows only make milk for their babies, just like humans. They make milk when they have babies. That said, modern milk cows only make milk all year round. And that's a mutation that we have selected for because it was useful for us. And we see this sort of domestication both in milk cows and meat cows, where the meat cows are super buff and they have a lot of meat, and milk cows have huge udders and make milk all the time. And these meat cows even go crazy sometimes. We've made something called a Belgian Blue, which is a super muscular cow that you can basically see the steaks on. It's a very expensive type of cow, by the way, because it took a lot of breeding to get there. So again, selective breeding of domesticated animals shows that artificial selection can cause evolution. Now, the last one, evolution of homologous structures by adaptive radiation explains similarities in structure when there are differences in function. So, homologous structures, what are these? Remember that all life is connected, right? Evolution suggests that a new species happens because one population divides and different natural selection in both change the populations over time until they are so different that even if they meet again, they cannot have babies. That's how speciation happens. And what that means is that the more closely related two species are, the more similar they should look. They should have more traits that are common. And that's because they inherited them from a common ancestor. Homologous structures are structures that are used for a different function. They are different structures, but they have the same fundamental plan and they're used for different purposes. So, if you want to do homologous structure in very simple way, the very simple way of saying it is different purpose, same basic plan, same basic structure. And this variations on the basic structure are what allow for the different functions. This is called adaptive radiation. Radiation is like the radii of a circle, and from one basic function, there have that same, sorry, one basic structure, that structure has adapted to be used for very different things, which allows for adaptation to different ways of life. Now, before going more into this, I actually want to go into the most famous example of homologous structure, which is the pentadactyl limb. What does penta mean? It means five, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What does dactyl mean? Well, how do you say finger in Italian or French? Right? Digito or doigt. And that's where dactyl comes from. So pentadactyl means the five-fingered limb. Now, mammals, birds, amphibians, reptiles all use different methods of locomotion or movement, yet they all have variations of the pentadactyl limb. The pentadactyl limb is the basic structure for the limbs of all tetrapods. All living things with two arms and two legs, or two wings and two legs, or four legs, four things, have a variation of the pentadactyl limb with the same basic pattern of five metacarpals and five phalanges. And that development, the reason that all of these living things, all mammals, birds, amphibians, and reptiles, have a variation of the pentadactyl limb is because we share a common ancestor. So we can see here A, B, C are the types of bones, and whether you are a human, a cow, a horse, a whale, a bird, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, and the ancestors of the 2, 3, 4, 5 are up here. Cows still have more of them, and here we have man. These bones are modified to suit the method of locomotion. Flying, with very thin, light bones, but... wait, that's not a bird, that's a bat. Sorry, that's a mistake there. That should be a bat. Where the bats have very thin arms, but long fingers, and they flap with their fingers. Whales, that have very thick bones for pushing water. Horses, that have one finger, it's actually their middle finger, so I won't emulate. And they stand on that finger with a very big nail, that's the hoof. Now that I think about it, this I don't think is a cow, I think it's a dog or something, but the flattened part to bear weight, and humans, of course, who don't move with our fingers, but we use them for walking, for holding things. And as such, we have those long fingers and the opposable thumb. Now, there's lots of different examples of the use of pentadactyl limb. In bats, they have the long fingers to fly with. Humans have opposable thumbs to hold things. Elephants, basically built like a column, very short fingers, all vertical. So their hands, by the way, are kind of flattened right with the bone on top. And that allows them to support a huge amount of weight. And again, the same basic bones. Even in a bird, where some of the fingers have started to disappear by natural selection because they were not useful, we still see the remains of three fingers with the same number of bones going all the way to the arm. One of my favorite examples of homologous structures, that is, structures with a different purpose, we're using them for different modes of locomotion, but the same basic plan, because they come from a common ancestor, right? Because they come from a common ancestor. One of my favorite examples is that of a whale. When you look at the whale, do you see any bone that looks strange? What about this one, the hip? Whales have legs. They're just stuck in their stomachs, and they're not even connected to their backs anymore. They're just floating in fat, and they're useless. But if we look at the evolution of a whale, we can see that over time, the whale started evolving from something that looks a little bit like a wolf and turned into something that looks like a whale today. So here's a little video of that.
What are we doing here? I thought we were studying whale evolution. We're on dry land.
All marine mammals evolve from land mammals, including whales. We're here to see Pachycetus. Wow, there it is.
It looks more like a pig dog than a whale.
Wait to see what happens to it as it evolves.
Yikes, I'm not getting in the water with that thing. The Ambulocetus does look like a link between a land animal and a whale, doesn't it?
Yes, it's pretty streamlined and hunts for fish, but probably comes onto the land to have its babies, although scientists can't be sure. And we are next to a river, not the sea, so it's not like a real whale.
Well, I know we're by the seaside, but I don't want to go swimming with that either.
Oh, come on in. Rhodocetus probably only eats fish. We're far too big for it to chew. And its nostrils are at the top of its head for easy breathing in the water.
This water is nice and warm. We must be in the tropics. Will it be as warm as the next place? Let's see what happens next as it evolves. The water is nice and warm here. Are we moving out to sea?
Yes, and look over there at that dolphin-sized creature. It's called a gyrodon.
A gyrodon? Now that really does look like a whale. It's got flippers instead of legs, and its nostrils have gone further up its head.
Yes, these evolutionary changes really suit the gyrodon to its home in the deep ocean. But I want to see a bigger mammal.
Wow, that's huge!
Yes, it's the Basilosaurus. They grew up to 20 meters in length.
It's like a stretched out whale. Look at its tiny head!
Everything is like a whale. Except the Basilosaurus still has nostrils. So what do whales have instead of nostrils? Blowholes! I'll show you. Time to return to our own time.
What's that noise?
It's a humpback.
It's huge and I can see its blowhole. Cool!
It's so different from a Pachycetus, where we started our journey.
You're not wrong.
And again, that whale evolution means that it still has this leftover homologous structure that is now useless. And over time, that bone is getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, because natural selection is meaning that whales that need to make less bones and still have the same survival rate are more likely to survive. The bone's actually useless. If you cut it out with surgery, the whale is fine. But it's a piece of evidence. This homologous structure is an evidence that life has changed over time and that we have common ancestors, which is one piece of proof for evolution. We can also see this in embryos. Vertebrate embryos share many basic similarities, and those similarities seem to suggest coming from a common ancestor. So you may have heard that humans actually have gills in the womb, and that's true. So humans, salamanders, chickens, pigs, monkeys, etc., all have very similar structures because of our ancestors. So if we look here, right at the beginning, all four of those types actually have gills because we had an ancestor that lived underwater. And then as they change, we can see all of them have tails because we come from an ancestor with tails. But as we grow in utero, in the womb, the parts that aren't used actually disappear. And that those homologous structures, those structures of the same basic design but used for different purposes, shows evidence of evolution. So things like gill pouches disappear, the tail stays in some but disappears in others. So again, fossils, homologous structures, and selective breeding show evidence of evolution because they show evidence, proof, of change in the heritable characteristics over time. Okay, we're done with part 1 of 5.1. Have a great rest of your day. Ciao!